Hi, today I will analyze the step down DC to DC converter. Last class I have discussed about basic working principle of a step down converter. There we have seen that output voltage equal to D into input voltage, and by controlling the duty cycle D between 1 to 0, we can reduce the output voltage. At the same time, we have seen that pulsating output voltage we have got across the load resistance. Then we have used a second order filter to filter out and make the output voltage usable form. Today I will analyze the complete DC to DC converter, continuous and discontinuous modes of operations we will see. Let's start. Last class I have connected a resistive load, but today a more general load, that is RLE load connected. RLE load is considered as a motor load. R resistance of the winding, L inductance, and E back EMF developed through the winding. So if you want to control the speed of the motor, you can control the input voltage, or you can control the duty cycle to control the output voltage. But in this case, output voltage will always be less than the input voltage. Let's see the waveform. During on period, we can see the current is increasing, and when the switch is off, then current decreases. In the top waveform, continuous current mode of operation is shown, and in the bottom waveform, it is discontinuous current. You can see in the continuous current, the load current is never zero, but in discontinuous current, the load current is zero for some duration of time. So this is the basic difference between continuous and discontinuous mode of operation. From design point of view, discontinuous and discontinuous modes of operation is very important for automatic control system or automatic speed control of DC motor. I will not go in detail about those control system. Here we will restrict our discussion to converter only. Let's proceed. The converter can be analyzed in two modes. When the switch is on, the mode 1, and when MOSFET is off, that is mode 2. In mode 1, you can see current will flow from DC voltage to RLE load, then back to input voltage. And when the switch is off, there is no current flowing through the DC source, but there will be current flowing through this diode. Reason behind it is that during on period, inductor will store some amount of energy and voltage will develop through the inductor. Now when the current reduces through the inductor, at that time the voltage across the inductor will be reversed. So here, because of the reverse voltage, this diode will be now forward biased and current will flow through inductor, E, diode and resistor, and the stored energy across the inductor is dissipated across the resistance, as well as some amount of energy is stored across the battery. If it is a battery, then it will store some amount of energy. So like this, current will flow. Here when the switch was on, then this diode gets reverse biased, and when the switch is off, diode gets forward biased. So continuous current you are getting across the load, but if the stored energy across the inductor is dissipated, or the voltage across the battery becomes more than the inductor voltage, then the diode will get reverse bias. Then the current will be zero. So that mode will be your discontinuous conductor. But if current continues to flow, then that is continuous conduction mode. Then again the switch will be made on, then inductor will charge, again the switch will be off, then inductor will discharge. So if the current is never zero across the load, then the mode is known as continuous conduction mode. And if the current is zero for some duration of time, then it is known as discontinuous conduction mode. So let's analyze this one mathematically. Here you can see in mode 1, the inductor current is increasing or the load current is increasing. And in mode 2, this load current is decreasing. Again, when the switch is made on, then current will increase. So here only continuous conduction mode is shown. So when the switch is on, this diode gets reverse bias and we can apply KVL equation across this circuit and we can write V is equal to RI1 plus L DI1 DT plus E. T is equal to on period of the switch plus off period of the switch. And already I have told that on period means mode 1 operation and off period means mode 2 operation. And the on period is equal to DT. You can see here D is equal to T1 by T. So T1 is equal to on period is equal to DT. Likewise, off period is equal to 1 minus D into D. T is your complete time period, T1 plus T2. So at T equal to 0, the switch is made on and the current is here I1. So this current I1 is the initial current of mode 1. And at T is equal to T1, finally it reaches I2. Now, this KVL equation V is equal to RI1 plus L DI1 DT plus E can be solved and you will get I1T is equal to capital I1 e to the power minus R by L into T plus V minus E by R 1 minus e to the power minus R by L into T. So this is the current expression in mode 1. So I1 and I2 you can find from this equation number 2. When T equal to 0 you will get this current I1. And when T is equal to T1, you will get this current I2. Let's analyze mode 2. In mode 2, the switch is off and the inductor will discharge through this diode. And the diode is known as freewheeling diode. As the inductor stored energy is freewheeled through this diode. So the KVL equation in this case is equal to 0 is equal to RI2 plus L DI2 DT plus E, because now the voltage source is not connected across this load, so the voltage is zero. At the same time you can see this diode is forward bias and the voltage drop across this diode is ideally zero. So zero is equal to RI2 plus L DI2 DT plus E equal to zero. Solving this equation number 3, you will get I2T is equal to I2 e to the power minus R by R into T minus E by R 1 minus e to the power minus R by L into T, and this is your current in mode 2, that means discharging current. So in mode 2, at T equal to 0, initial current is I2 and the final current at T equal to T2 is I1. Then from there, again when the switch is on, mode 1 will start. So mode 1 from I1 to I2 and mode 2 from I2 to I1. So individually this mode 1 and mode 2 is analyzed. Now we can club together to find the ripple current I2 minus I1. See, from equation number 2, this equation, at T equal to T1 or DT, the current is I2, that means final current of mode 1. So I2 is equal to I1 e to the power minus R by L into DT plus V minus E by R 1 minus e to the power minus R by L into DT. Likewise, from equation number 4 or mode 2, if T is equal to T2 or 1 minus D into T, so you can see that is your I1. So substituting that T equal to 1 minus D into T, you will get I1 is equal to I2 e to the power minus R by L into 1 minus dt minus E by R 1 minus e to the power minus R by L into 1 minus dt. So equation number 6 will give you I1 and equation number 5 I2. So solving these two equations, we can get the value of this I1 and I2 independent of any other current. So I1 is equal to V by R e to the power dTr by L minus 1 e to the power tR by L minus 1 minus of E by R, and I2 is equal to V by R e to the power minus dTr by L minus 1 e to the power minus tR by L minus 1 minus E by R. So peak to peak ripple current, that means maximum minus minimum value is equal to del I, and that we will get is equal to V by R 1 minus e to the power minus dTr by L plus e to the power minus tR by L minus e to the power minus 1 minus dTr by L divided by 1 minus e to the power minus tR by L. Now to find what will be the maximum ripple current and at what duty cycle it will happen, we can differentiate this value with respect to B and equate it to 0. First order derivative of this del I with respect to dd equal to 0 will give you duty cycle at which this ripple current will be maximum. So you will get d is equal to 0.5. So 50% duty cycle will give maximum ripple current, and that maximum ripple current is equal to vt by 4l, and t is equal to total time period, and t equal to 1 by frequency, f is the switching frequency. So del I maximum is equal to vt by 4fl. Very important equation. From here you can find maximum value of ripple current, or you can find the size of the inductor knowing other parameters. And one more thing we can conclude from here, that size of the inductor is reduced if we are operating our device at high frequency. So if the switching frequency is very high, then size of the inductor is low. So this will be very important advantage of this equation. And to reduce the size of the inductor, very high frequency switches like MOSFET, IGBTs are used. And these above equations are derived for continuous conduction mode. If you want to derive for discontinuous conduction mode, then make I minimum or I1 equal to 0, and likewise you proceed, you will get the value of maximum ripple current in discontinuous conduction mode, and you can design your converter accordingly. So today we have discussed about DC to DC converter, continuous and discontinuous mode of operation. We have seen that during on period inductor gets charged, and during off period inductor discharges, and the discharging path is given by the freewheeling diode in our circuit. Then we have found out the maximum value of ripple current. From there we have concluded that if we are operating our switches at very high frequency, then the size of the inductor will reduce. At the same time, if you don't want to allow more amount of ripple current, or I2 minus I1 you want to reduce, then go for larger size inductor, or at higher frequency you operate, then the ripple current will be very low. So these parameters are very important in designing the DC to DC converters, and same is applicable to other converters also. In next class we will discuss about some other DC to DC converter. Thank you.